Hey there, Rock of Roseville Church family. So excited to share a virtual message with you in this season. When I was with you back in May, you might recall, I shared a prophetic dream about something I believe is in God's heart, a new student gospel movement for the state of California. I want you to know that the message I want to share this morning or today with you, I believe God wants to use it to renew our minds and to position our spiritual vision so that we can align with God's heart, His vision, His purpose for this season ahead. I believe, again, one of His purposes is a new student gospel movement in the state of California. I pray that you are blessed beyond measure by this message today. Well, today the message I want to bring to you is titled, Lift Up Your Eyes. It's taken from a passage in John chapter 4, one of my favorite passages in all of the Bible about Jesus' encounter with a woman of Samaria. The practice of lifting up our eyes, as we'll see today, is actually a spiritual or devotional practice whereby we align our vision and our thinking with God's heavenly perspective. This practice of lifting up our eyes, I believe, is critical for the Church of Jesus Christ today. We live in incredibly polarized, turbulent times, if you haven't noticed. We desperately need our minds renewed. That comes when, based on what we're looking at. That our minds get renewed based on what we're gazing upon. The Bible says, don't be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's pleasing, perfect will is. It's in God's heart that you and I would be able to discern His will. That comes, though, through the renewing of our minds. Today, as I give this message on lift up your eyes, I want to invite us into this holy devotional practice of raising our gaze and gaining God's heavenly perspective of the world around us. This whole practice of lifting my eyes has actually been quite critical to me in this last season. As I mentioned, I have the opportunity to lead a student outreach movement here in our county in Middle Tennessee. In fact, pre-pandemic, the 3 months leading up to the COVID-19 pandemic, we saw over 800 students come to Christ. A remarkable harvest. Post-pandemic season, this new school year, we've reestablished our work, recruited new student leaders. We've been ministering, gathering 500 to 600 high school students every month here in Middle Tennessee. The gospel is going forth in power and lives are being changed. In my experience, this has been the most dynamic student harvest that I've ever had personal opportunity to be connected to. And yet, as I look back on the history leading up to my involvement with student outreach work here, I recognize that this practice of lifting my eyes has been so critical to aligning my perspective so that I could be most useful to God in this recent season. And that's exactly what happened. Today we're going to look at some of the blessings and the power that's released in our life when we lift our eyes. We're also going to look at some of the cost, some of the difficulty that we have to overcome in order to align to God's heavenly perspective. Again, John chapter 4 is where we begin. This is Jesus' encounter with the woman of Samaria. Many of us are familiar with this passage. Jesus has an encounter with this woman. He receives words of knowledge about her immoral past, and yet instead of shaming her or condemning her, she's invited into connection, relationship with Jesus. I love that about Jesus. She goes into the town of Samaria saying, come and meet the man who told me everything I ever did. The town is coming out to him, and Jesus' disciples have now approached him. A little cultural background, Jews, like Jesus' disciples, had religious and racial hatred for Samaritan people. So these are two people groups in conflict. And this is where we pick up. As the town is coming out to meet Jesus, Jesus is speaking to his Jewish disciples, and he says this to them, do you not say there are yet 4 months and then comes the harvest? Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes. See that the fields are white for harvest. Already the ones who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life so that the sower may reap, may rejoice together in the reap with the reaper. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I have sent you to reap for that which you do not labor. Others have labored and you have entered into their labor. Jesus was giving this call to his disciples to lift up their eyes as the town of Samaria is walking out to meet him. In the context of this religious, racial, theological hatred between these two people groups, it's actually quite profound. Jesus was inviting his disciples, the 12, to actually lift their eyes out of their cultural, religious, theological, even racial bigotry, and to see the unique moment they were in. A whole village was being open to the gospel of Jesus Christ. This was an unprecedented moment in the disciples' journey with Jesus in his ministry. And they had a challenge to overcome in order to gain heavenly perspective. The challenge was their own theological, racial, even political differences with the people that Jesus wanted to reach. Doesn't that sound like much of the church today? Here in the Church of America, we are in desperate need of lifting our eyes to gain God's perspective for the world around us. God forbid that we fall into the trap of the evil one and simply live like the world does, labeling everyone around us according to their political differences, their ethnic backgrounds, or their familial backgrounds. Instead, we need to lift our eyes and see, Jesus says, the fields are white and ready for harvesting. You know, from earth perspective, we might look at the United States of America and see tensions and hatred and divisions and extremism and misinformation and bigotry and racism. We might see all these tensions on earth, but from heaven's perspective, what if from God's perspective, he sees a royal and holy opportunity for the gospel to go forth in supernatural power, even through this church family here? Jesus, in this moment, this call to lift up our eyes, the disciples' eyes, he was actually borrowing a phrase from the Old Testament. This is actually a phrase that was repeated throughout the Old Testament. I'm reading through the Old Testament right now. I continually see this phrase in my Bible reading plan. Today we want to look at just a few other verses in the Old Testament where this phrase is used, lift up your eyes. And as we look at these passages, we're going to look at some of the blessings associated with lifting up our eyes, as well as some of the things people had to overcome in order to align to God's heavenly perspective. The first passage we want to begin with has to do with Abram, the man who became Abraham. Genesis chapter 13, verses 14 through 16. The Lord said to Abram after Lot had separated from him, "Lift up your eyes and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, westward, for the land that you see, I will give to you and your offspring forever. I will make your offspring as the dust of the earth, so that if one could count the dust of the earth, your offspring could also be counted." The historical context is important here. That first verse, after Lot separated from Abram, that's when God began to speak to him. This is really important because Lot was Abram's family. And because of this tribal familial dispute, Lot separates from Abram, his relative. They had been pilgrimaging together. They moved literally out of the country together across the known world. And it was in this context that they began to split ways. They part ways. Their families, their tribes part ways. Can you imagine like the despair, the sorrow, the disappointment that Abram was feeling at this moment to see his relative who had traveled with him, who had paid the cost of moving out of country with him, to begin parting ways because of a familial dispute? It was in this place of disappointment, sorrow, and despair that God began to speak to Abram, and he called him to lift up his eyes. This is good news for you and me, because in a post-COVID reality, in a post-2020 world, where many of us have experienced the tensions of this last season, perhaps our families have experienced the tensions of an unprecedented presidential election and all the drama that comes with that around the family table. It's in this season of despair, of loss, hopelessness, even sorrow, that God comes to you and me, and he comes to us with a holy invitation again. Would you lift up your eyes? In other words, you and I cannot afford to let sorrow, disappointment, and our losses in this last season determine how we perceive the season ahead and the things that God wants to do. We need to lift up our eyes. We need to gain heaven's perspective about our lives. And the Bible says hope does not disappoint. For the love of God has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. It's high time that we lift our eyes and we pull ourselves out of any remnant of despair, of emotion that keeps our perspective tied down to lesser level thinking. The next passage we want to look at is Genesis chapter 31, verse 10 through 12. This is with Jacob. Remember, the patriarchs go Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. This is third generation guy here. And in verse 10, the Bible says, "In the breeding season of the flock," Jacob speaking, "I lifted my eyes and I saw in a dream." So he has his God dream in this moment, "that the goats that mated with the flock were striped, spotted, and mottled." You're like, what's this all about? Okay, pause right here. The little background is that Jacob was serving a relative in his relative's home, Laban. Laban made a deal with Jacob, but it was actually an unfair deal. Jacob was being cheated by this relative named Laban. And now Jacob, his inheritance, his payment was he was going to receive the spotted and the mottled animals, whereas Laban was going to keep all the pure animals. But it was in that season of being cheated and of experiencing injustice and pain, even in the context of family, that this happened. Jacob says, "In that season, I lifted up my eyes and I dreamt a dream. I received a God dream. And the goats that mated with the flock were striped, spotted, and mottled. Then the angel of God said to me in a dream," he said, "Jacob." And I said, "Here I am." And he said, "Lift up your eyes and see all the goats that mate with the flock that are striped, spotted, and mottled, for I have seen all that Laban is doing to you." Now I want you to think about this, okay? Because Jacob was living under unfair authority. He was living under governance in Laban's home that overextended its bounds. He was being mistreated by the authority that he was living under. He was experiencing unjust leadership. And it was actually in that season that the Lord came to him and called him not to look merely at the fact that he was being cheated, that his rights were being oppressed, that he was being victimized by Laban's authority in his life. But instead, God was saying, "Would you lift your eyes, Jacob? If you could see right now, you would see that I am redeeming this situation and I'm working all things for the good." Again, this is good news for you and me, who as Christians in the 21st century of North America, we recognize that we live in a society and a culture, even a political climate that's growing increasingly hostile toward all things biblical worldview and all things gospel. And as we move forward in this direction, as we experience increased levels of injustice, or we witness increased expressions where political authorities, governmental authorities are abusing their power, perhaps even at the expense of God's people, we need to remember that it's in that context that God came to Jacob, the one he loves. Jacob, who would become Israel, after whom all of the people of God would be named. We are spiritual Israel. God comes to us and he says, "Would you lift your eyes? Would you not live merely under the offense at the world around you? The offense at politics, governance, unfair treatment, the offense at what you perceive as your rights being trampled over. Would you not merely live under that offense, but instead would you lift your eyes? And would you see that some of the things that I am doing in your midst can actually cause all things to work together for the good, for your good in this context?" This is a powerful promise for you and me. As we lift our eyes, as we engage that, again, it's a devotional practice of fixing our gaze from that higher place. This happens in Scripture, as we read Scripture. This happens in prayer. This happens as we hear the word of the Lord preached to us, or even as we receive prophetic words from others. We have an opportunity to lift our eyes and to renew the way we think. And this is becoming increasingly important for the church today and in the days ahead. Recently, I had a really cool opportunity to lift my eyes. It was actually a year ago that we were in the middle of the spring season. The pandemic was in full force. Shutdown was in full force. I wasn't able to travel. I wasn't able to serve churches. This becomes a little bit difficult, seeing as how as a ministry, our budget, our revenue is generated as I travel, as I serve churches, and as more people buy some of our resources that we make available at those events. And it was in this season that I went further into prayer, further into scripture, further into a time of seeking the Lord, just like many church leaders did all over the world during the early part of shutdown. And I was asking the Lord, like, Lord, how are we going to move forward in this season? I can't even go to serve church down the street. And it was actually in that season I was thinking about our budget. I was thinking about ministry. I was thinking about what next, Lord? And I had a dream. It was a God dream. And in the dream, it was so cool. I knew it was about someone else's calling. And God had given specific wisdom and insight and words of knowledge about this person's calling that would be crucial to them moving forward. And it would be helpful to them moving forward. I woke up and I thought, Lord, I usually get dreams like in advance of ministry trips that I can share on the road. They can be a blessing to people, but I'm not going anywhere. Like, how am I going to be able to share this message that you've given me with someone else? I wonder who's going to get a hold of me today. It was actually later that afternoon that I received an email from a businessman in Asia. And I was actually in Asia something like 18 months prior to this moment, doing a conference actually in Hong Kong. And I'd minister to this family of this Asian family. And God just, the Holy Spirit beautifully poured out in this time of ministry. They were blessed. I was blessed. And we hadn't seen each other. Of course, 18 months later, I received an email from him. He's checking in. I don't remember what the nature of the email was, but I felt prompted from the Lord to ask him how his oldest son was doing. He shares then with me a little background, and I knew immediately that based on what his report was for their family and their oldest son, that this dream and the message associated with his dream was for this young man. And so I sent him the email. I typed out the word. I sent it to him. I said, I think this is a message from the Lord to your family and to your oldest son. A couple weeks later, I get another message from them. They're ecstatic. They're over the moon. They said that word was absolutely from the Lord. It was so remarkable that God gave it to me on the other side of the world the same day he felt compelled to email me. And actually, it led to spiritual revival, personal revival in their family's life and in their son's life. And to make a long story short, they're navigating some critical decisions now that will lead to his future calling as a result of the wisdom and the insight presented in that dream. Only God, you know. It was actually a couple of weeks later that we received a financial gift from this family as a thank you for our ministry to them. And I just thought, isn't that the Lord? In a season where I can't go down the street to minister at a church, I certainly can't go to Asia, I can't go to Hong Kong, I can't even go down the street. Churches aren't open, but I can go to bed, I can go to sleep. And it's profound. That's all it took for God to begin to speak. It was in a dream that God lifted my eyes and he began to give me perspective about what he's doing in the life of someone else on the other side of the planet. I was thinking about that going, I can't go down the street to church, but I can go to bed. And Lord, somehow this leads to financial provision to our ministry. I was just dumbfounded at the goodness of God. And then the Father spoke to me and he said, you know, I do some of my best work when you're at rest in me. I do some of my best work when you're at rest in me. When we lift our eyes, it puts us into a place of supernatural rest in God. Because we know that, like John chapter 5, Jesus said, my Father is right now working. When we know that God is at work, even when in our circumstances it looks like he's not moving at all. When we lift our eyes and we fix our heart around that theological conviction, my Father is now working, it gives us a heavenly perspective that we can then enter into our current deficient circumstances with hope, with faith, with joy and peace, believing that God is right now working. The last passage that we want to look at, it comes from Isaiah chapter 40. This is another passage where this phrase, lift up your eyes, was used. verse 26 to 20, 25 to 26. To whom then will you compare me? This is God speaking, that I should be like him. Says the Holy One, lift up your eyes on high and see who created these things. He said, he who brings out the host by their number, calling them by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. God is speaking to Israel, and he's like, man, who are you going to compare me to? Think about it. He says, the one who calls the host by their number and calls them and created these things and calls them by name. God is speaking to Israel, and he's like, to whom are you going to compare me? There is a challenge that echoes to us as God's people today from this passage. God is calling us to lift our eyes into a holy awe of who he is and what he can do. I think we suffer from too small a view of God. We suffer from too small and deficient view of God, his character, his nature. One of my favorite authors, A.W. Tozer, he said this. He said, what comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. Worship is either pure or it's base or lame, as the worshiper entertains high or low thoughts of God. That's A.W. Tozer. I mentioned that would be the last verse, but I want to share one more. Psalm 121, verse 1 through 2. This is the psalmist. He says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. This is where we gather the idea that the practice of lifting our eyes is actually a devotional practice. It's something that we do by discipline as a means of grace toward experiencing the kingdom of God in our life. The psalmist shows us here that he made a daily devotional practice of lifting his eyes to the hills where his help came from. The helper being, of course, the Spirit of God. The helper, of course, being God himself, who comes to us in our moments of weakness, who comes to us when we lift our eyes. I want to challenge us today in light of this message, beyond today, beyond Sunday, as we move forward into our week, as you wake up Monday morning, stand, both feet on the ground, out of the bed, or kneel, lift your head and say, Lord, I'm lifting my eyes today where my help comes from. I'm refusing today to embrace a merely humanistic lens where I look at reality around me, I look at my circumstances, I look at the way people are treating me, I look at the sadness or the sorrow that in my life, I look at these things in my life merely through humanistic lenses. Humanistic lens has no hope. A humanistic lens can only calculate by the resources of the flesh to determine what can happen next. But instead, Lord, I am saying I will lift my eyes. I'm going to enter into my day with a holy perspective, full of hope, joy, peace, believing that you are moving. The Father's right now working, and he's working all things for the good of those who love him. This is a message for you and I to receive. I believe God has high and holy purposes for this unique hour of human history. I'm convinced that this backdrop, that of this cultural, historic, even political backdrop of pressure, shakings, intensity, difficulty, tribulation that we're experiencing in this recent season is simply a landscape backdrop that is going to enable the glory of God breaking in to shine all the more. What happens when God's glory breaks in? Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Behold, darkness covers the earth, deep darkness the peoples, but my glory shall rise and shall be seen upon you, declares the Lord. What happens when this happens? The Bible says this, nations shall come to your light. You know that God's heart is for the nations, the people groups around the world in this season. What else happens? He says, kings to the brightness of your rising. You know that the political figures that you and I might have an aversion to, the people of authority and influence on the earth, some of whom we follow and some of whom we reject, God has a heart for the kings, the queens, if you will, on the earth, who carry influence and authority. And it's in his heart that all of them would repent and believe the gospel. You know what happens when God's glory rises on a people? Verse 4 of Isaiah 60 says, lift up your eyes. There it is, the phrase again. And see, they all gather together. They come to you. Your sons and your daughters come from afar. Your daughters shall be carried on the hip. When God's glory rises on his people, there's a youth movement. Sons and daughters coming from afar. There's a supernatural work of the Spirit in the next generation. I think that's in God's heart for this unique hour of American history, that God would raise up a new Jesus movement for this generation. We have no other hope but God breaking in with his glory, with miracles, with signs, with wonders, accompanying the clear and unadulterated preaching of the gospel, as Jesus's people everywhere live in his love, his truth, and his power, and minister the truth of the kingdom of God to a broken and destitute generation around us. May this be the season that God's people, we lift our eyes. May this be the season that we see God's glory rising on us. May this be the season that God begins to move with a fresh wave of a new Jesus movement for the United States of America.